Good morning. It's so wonderful to be here. It's so wonderful to see you all here. Thank you, everyone who is worshiping with us online. Today is World Communion Sunday. It's an exciting time of gathering at the communion table here and with congregations and other fellow Christians all around the world. If you are at home worshiping, please make sure that you have some wine or juice or bread or something to share with us in communion today as well. We are very glad to welcome the Reverend Carolyn Boyd to help lead us in worship this morning. Reverend Boyd is the pastor of Congregational Care at Hope United Church of Christ in Alexandria, Virginia. We are thankful also for new microphones hanging from the sky here. That said, as Jeff said this morning, we're also working on the fly with them. So if you're listening online and the sound is off for a moment, be patient. We're adapting as we go to this wonderful new resource. Today, we are receiving the Neighbors in Need Special Mission Offering, which supports ministries of justice and compassion throughout the United States, including the Council for American Indian Ministries, Justice and Advocacy, and direct service projects supported by justice and local church ministries. A month-long church-wide mission project also launches today in support of neighbors right here in Frederick County. ERUCC's Mission and Social Action Committee invite you to do some reverse trick-or-treating of sorts to support the shelter programs of the Religious Coalition. There are items that are listed in your bulletin, such as travel-sized toiletry, snacks, and bottled water that you could bring in as donations to the collection table in the upper lobby out here, outside of the sanctuary. And today, our children and youth may stay up front at the rug after the thought for the day today to decorate some of our collection boxes that we'll use. As a reminder for our community, October 15th, we'll be encouraged to attend a presentation on Trinity Chapel and the historic clock tower after the service. That is at 9:30, after the 8:30 service. And during this time, in the community room, the property committee and others will review the findings that came from the engineer and the contractor, and we'll look at the possible options for a path forward and make some of the decisions that our congregation needs to make around that. At fellowship today, you're invited down for a little heartier spread than usual, and so please do join us as we gather with some casserole dishes and time together. Please again know that your bulletin and items online will share with you more things that are active in our church and our community in ways that you can connect with us here. I invite you now to take a moment and greet those nearby, and turn and also greet those online as we gather in worship today.
Please pray with me. As we journey through this time of transition, remembering our past and welcoming our future, we, the members of this congregation, seek to celebrate in word and deed the gospel of Jesus Christ by nurturing spiritual growth through worship, study, and prayer, caring for one another as God cares for us, and proclaiming God's love for all people as we work to help our neighbors near and far. We commit ourselves to develop and implement specific programs to fulfill our missions, remembering the work of our ancestors, actively participating in our congregation's life, and laying of foundation for our generations to follow. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
This table. And if you stand, if you're able to share now in the call to worship, it's going to look a little bit different. On this sacred day of World Communion, let us come together, opening our hearts to the transformative power of surrender. Just as the religious leaders questioned Jesus' authority, we too seek truth and guidance in our lives. With humility, we stand before the sacred presence, surrendering our false selves on this special day. Together, let our faith shine forth, illuminating our journey on this World Communion Day. These breads that we are bringing forth are symbols of the many different peoples within the family of God from all over the world. We present them now coming from north, south, east, and west, gathering for worship on this World Communion Sunday.
Matzah is unleavened bread and reminds us of all who eat their bread in haste. It symbolizes for us all the refugees who, like the ancient Israelites, leave their homes and flee from danger. Pita bread is a staple throughout the Middle East. We place it on the table today to remember our Palestinian brothers and sisters who hunger for justice. May these breads remind us, too, of the homeless in our own city and country. We pray, O God, for your church among those with no place to call home. May we learn from their searching faith, and may we be a place of welcome for all who seek safety.
Chapati, a bread eaten in parts of Africa and India, reminds us that they were the birthplace of humankind, where Christianity continues to flourish. It also reminds us of a legacy of slavery and of a people who endured. We pray, O God, for your church in places where it flourishes, and we confess the times and places when we have enslaved our brothers and sisters. May we learn from the vibrant faith of our African and Indian brothers and sisters, and may we build a more just and peaceful world.
Naan reminds us of Asia, where Christians are a minority among Muslims, Buddhists, Hindus, and others. It represents for us the ways our faith calls us beyond our culture and reminds us of our brothers and sisters who are persecuted for their beliefs. We pray, O God, for your church in places where Christianity is dangerous, politically or socially. May we learn from the steadfast faith of our Asian brothers and sisters and walk with Jesus through every trial.
Tortillas remind us of Central and South America, where faith and culture have colored one another beautifully, but also a place where Christians live with violence, drugs, and conflict as a daily reality. We pray, O God, for your church in places beset by violence and still colored by hope. May we learn from the persistent faith of our Latino brothers and Latina sisters, and may we look upon them with compassion as our neighbors.
The Bagat reminds us of Europe with its vast cathedrals that are often empty. It represents those who keep the faith alive and lean in and lean times, and reminds us that the church is not a building but a community of people. We pray, O God, for your church in places where its power is diminished and its followers are few. May we lean from the age-old faith of our European brothers and sisters, and may we live our faith so our faith might live.
Cornbread reminds us of the Native Americans who first recognized God in the rhythms of nature. It reminds us that the land we call home once belonged to others. We pray, O God, for your church as it exists in every land. May we learn from the earthly faith of our Native American brothers and sisters, and may we care for the land and all those who call it home.
Will you share with me in the opening prayer printed in your bulletin? Gracious and loving God, as we gather here on this sacred World Communion Day, we come before you with hearts full of gratitude and anticipation. We thank you for this special moment's gift and the privilege of coming together in worship and reflection with brothers and sisters around the world. Lord, we open our hearts and minds to your presence and recognize the global community of faith joining us in this moment. May your Holy Spirit descend upon this place, filling it with light and love, and extend its grace to every corner of the earth where your children gather. Grant us wisdom and understanding as we delve into the depths of your word and the teachings of our faith. May our worship today be a testament to the unity of your people, regardless of borders or backgrounds. As we embark on this journey of faith, may our hearts be open to your truth, our minds receptive to your wisdom, and our spirits ready to be transformed. May the words spoken and heard today draw us closer to you and one another, strengthening the bonds of communion that transcend all boundaries. In your holy name we pray. Amen. As we gather on this World Communion Day, let us celebrate the unity of the global body of Christ and reflect on our journeys of faith. Just as the religious leaders questioned Jesus' authority, we too have moments of doubt and pride, and at times are swayed by our false egos. Let us now confess to God, acknowledging our need for divine guidance and transformation. Gracious and merciful God, on this World Communion Day, we gather in the unity of our faith tradition. We confess our human tendencies to question and doubt, to let pride overshadow humble obedience. As we share in this global celebration of communion, we are one creation. On this World Communion Day, where faithful companions eat and drink in remembrance of you, today, as we reflect on the lessons of surrender, obedience, and authentic faith,
dear God, Holy One, thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for our confessions of faith. knowing that there is nothing we can do, no place we can go, no height or depth that we are ever from your love. Thank you for forgiveness and redemption, and thank you for your transforming power. Thank you. Amen.
So if you are young or young at heart, I welcome you to gather on the carpet today for our thought for the day. Good morning. Hey, let's try that again. I heard a couple good morning. Good morning. Are we waking up?
Yes.
Good. It's a blessing to have you here today, friends. Today we're gonna hear in one of our scripture lessons some commandments about that God gives to others. And so I've been thinking about the commandments that I hear in our faith, and there are three that are sticking out for me today that I want to talk to you about. One is, in all things give thanks. Will you say that with me?
All things.
Yeah, that's excellent. Brooklyn, awesome. I am glad you're here with me. Will you say that again, everyone, with Brooklyn and I? In all things give thanks.
In all things give thanks.
Good. And how about love thy neighbor? Will you say that with me?
Love my neighbor.
Great. And then number three, feed the hungry.
Feed the hungry.
Have you ever thought about those things as commands from God to us?
Yes.
Yes, excellent. Marley? Ah, yes. We'll talk about that in a moment. So Marley had a good question that we'll answer in just a moment. So whenever we come to the table to eat together, we give thanks, right?
Yeah.
I hope that when we have a snack or when we sit down to dinner together, do you give thanks? If you don't, then maybe this can be a reminder to have that practice, right? In all things, give thanks. Marley asked if we get to eat the bread today. And so our bread today is on the communion table, and we will get to gather and share that together. When we come to the communion table, do you expect that we give thanks?
Yes.
Yes. Yes, we do give thanks. And we also experience God's love for us, and the promise and the sending to go and love our neighbor, right? So there's two of those commands. No matter where we are around the world, no matter what our life circumstance is, we are welcomed at this table and we are nourished in our faith, right? Are you with me? All right. So I want to say something now, a moment about this. What does this look like for you?
A pumpkin.
A pumpkin, yes. A jack-o'-lantern, yes. Satan? It could be a grocery bag. They're very intellectual folks here. Yes, Emmy? It could be for Halloween. That was what I was going for. Right. But, so soon, you might do some trick-or-treating. I have grown to love trick-or-treating night when I'm in a town or community, when there are a lot of neighbors. Because neighbors give to one another with joy. There is a gift of giving thanks. Are you taught when, if you go trick-or-treating and you go to someone's door and they put something in, are you taught to say thank you?
Yes.
Yes, we do. We practice that, right? And they are giving gifts out of love with much joy. So we've got thanks and joy. And often the gifts are food, right? I love that day. We greet one another with love and joy and thanks. However, there are some times when, as neighbors, not all of us have enough food, right? And on Halloween, the last few years, I've been thinking, what would it be like on the other days if somebody knocked on a door and asked for food? Is that usual?
Yes.
No.
It is? If it is usual for you, that's awesome. That's something, a gift in your neighborhood. I don't find that to be very usual, right? I think usually when people will knock on their neighbor's door, if they don't know their neighbor, then people get suspicious
and cautious, and often will put a door shut in their face, right? And so a couple comments, Brooklyn.
That's not usual, except if you buy food.
So if you buy food for others, it's more usual? Okay, Zayden, what were you gonna say?
If they wanted to give you something, like a cake.
Oh, sometimes a neighbor will bring you to your house cakes or food. Yes, so we can be giving and hospitable that way, yes?
If you're selling cookies or candy for Eagle Scouts.
Yes, so sometimes if you are selling something for your Scouts or other group, people receive you. But it is not often that when people just come to a door and say, I'm hungry, do you have food? That we give it with full, loving hearts. It's not a practice that we usually have. Now, this month, we've made a commitment as a church to say we're going to shift that practice for us. And we're going to collect things to give to our neighbors. And we're going to collect things that help clean houses or clean spaces if they don't have houses. We're going to collect snacks. We're going to collect water. We're going to collect a lot of things. And some of you have talked about this in your Sunday school. And so that is a way that we give thanks and that we share God's love and that we feed the hungry. Are you open to doing that together with us?
Yes.
Awesome. Awesome, friends. So today, if you would like to, during the sermon time, you may stay up here if you want to work quietly and decorate these boxes as places that we will gather our reverse trick-or-treats to be able to give and share with neighbors. Does that sound good?
Yeah, about Junior Church.
Question?
Is there Junior Church today?
There's not Junior Church, which is why we're having that gathering time. So, will you pray with me, friends?
Yes.
Yep, we can look at the things in the boxes in just a moment. All right. God, thank you so much for my group's enthusiasm to make crafts and to make these boxes. Thank you for the many ways that you are showing up in their lives and the fact that they want to give and connect with neighbors, Lord. Thank you for the many ways that you bring us together in this church, around the communion table, here and everywhere in the world. For the reminder, God, that we all have a place at your table. And we all have the right to have food. God, thank you also for the words that you give us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
So our scripture reading today is from Matthew chapter 21, verses 23 through 32, which is the authority of Jesus questioned, and then the parable of the two sons. When he entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it human origin?" And they argued with one another. "If we say, 'From heaven,' he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say, 'Of human origin,' we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things." What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, "Son, go and work in the vineyard today. He answered, I will not. But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, but he answered, I go, sir. And he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said, the first. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes that are going into the kingdom are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him, and even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. The word of God for the people of God.
What a privilege and joy to be with you today. I'm going to give you a little hint at the beginning of my sermon. If you say amen, or wave your hand, or give me a big old smile, we can get out quicker. Good morning, beloved members and friends. And how blessed I am to be present and alive in this very special sacred gathering on World Communion Day. I bring greetings from Hope United Church of Christ in Alexandria, Virginia, where my senior pastors, Amber Nura, to Reverend Kristen, and these beautiful kids, I just enjoy watching them, and to your church leadership, and to you in the sanctuary today, I greet you and give you my blessings. To Reverend Charissa, in her absence, I am grateful for the invitation to preach, and I must give my husband lots of hugs and kisses, for being such a wonderful partner to me. When I have to preach, I get to not do my wifely duties, and so he gives me space to do what I must do as a child of God. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the gift of this community, the opportunity to worship together, and the chance to explore your word. We come before you with hearts wide open and minds eager, and spirit hunger for your wisdom. May your Holy Spirit guide us as we seek understanding and inspiration from the teachings of Matthew. We pray that the words spoken today are a source of encouragement, enlightenment, and empowerment. Grant us the grace to listen, to learn, and live out your powerful, life-affirming truth. In all that is holy and gracious, we pray, amen. How do you surrender, obey, live an unwavering faith to manifest in your life? I would like for you to take a moment and consider your own experiences and thoughts through the essence and the principles of faith. Do you have faith? Amen. Amen for the faith. Now, I can do my black sermon. Or I could do my white sermon. So you might get a combination of both, all right? It's really great. I want the Holy Spirit to be present. And you know the Holy Spirit is present because you brought him and I brought him, all right? Let's get started. Please take your seats. This is the first Captain Carolyn Boyd with the USS Faith Voyager. The first model time traveling machine will arrive in the newly renovated West End Vineyards Resorts just outside of Jerusalem. Faithful travel companions, our spiritual journey transcends time and space. Venturing back to a long forgotten era, we are touching down right now, landing in the vineyard just beyond the walls of ancient Jerusalem. According to the multi-universe time portal, we are here on time, securing our prime line seats, just 2 rows from Jesus's makeshift platform. It's World Community Day, and spiritual travelers and seekers have come from all over the multi-universe to witness this historic smackdown between the religious leaders and Jesus. For this special event, the marquee headline reads, "Hardliners Questions Jesus Street Creds." The source is reported to be the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21, and verses 23 and 32. She read them so beautifully. Thank you very much. Here, Jesus focuses his comments on the 2 sons who are asked by their father to do some work in the vineyard. Sometimes sons and daughters can be very lazy. Each son responds uniquely different to their father's command to work in the vineyard. We find 1 son who initially resists, but later surrenders, while the other son merely agrees with words, but fails to translate his words into action. These 2 sons mirror our inner struggles. Like the 1st son, we may have moments of resistance where our immediate response is defiance. Anybody here was a defiant teenager? We question, we hesitate, we falter. Yet, as time passes, we find the grace to obey, to align our will with our Father, or our human Father, or our divine Father, to a higher purpose. Now, I wish I had some time to preach on that higher purpose thing, because we have a lot of people writing books and going to study classes and, oh, I want to be in my purpose. Well, if you listen to what I'm saying, you will understand that your purpose comes through your surrender of God. But again, that's a whole nother sermon. However, we may be reminded of ourselves in the actions or inactions of the 2nd son too. He speaks words of agreement. Yes, Father, I will work in the vineyard. Yes, I will. But fails to put his words into action. From the 2nd son, we learn that we might profess faith and use elegant words, yet our deeds and our actions do not reflect the sincerity of our hearts, or sometimes maybe they actually do reflect our hearts. We glimpse the dual nature of us as human beings. Sometimes I like to say we're a little fickle, we're a little inconsistent, sometimes maybe even a little hypocritical, but I'm sure, Reverend Christian, there's nobody in the congregation who are in any way hypocritical here. And sometimes we're a little selfish, and we get in our feelings. We get stuck in our mind with all the reasons why we should do whatever it is we're trying to justify. Thank God for loving us through the letting go stage. Thank God for loving us through the surrendering of our sense of importance phrase. Thank God for loving us when we want to control everything. Now, who said that amen? Oh, okay, good. Oh, amen, amen. I thought that was my husband because he's always telling me I'm trying to control him. Which of the 2 sons are you most like? What would you say about faith if you were one of the religious scholars and leading philosophers? Let me share with you. Early in my career, I had to make a significant career, life-altering decision. It stirred up all kinds of emotions and, quite frankly, fears in me. I was offered an incredible position at a highly respected faith institution in Baltimore. It beckoned me to leave all behind and relocate to an unfamiliar place with no friends, no support systems, and no guarantee that I would be successful. I was scared. I hate to admit that, but yes, I was scared. And I didn't want to disappoint anybody. I didn't want to disappoint my mentors, my supporters, my mom and dad. And mostly, I didn't want to disappoint myself. I hope y'all know what that feels like. Much like the two sons in our parable, I wrestled and wrestled and I resisted and I resisted. And I called myself being authentic. I'm going to be my authentic self. Whatever that means. And God called me to surrender, and I'm like, no, I'm not going. Despite all of that, my fear, my trepidation, I put on my big, you know, that saying, okay, I won't say it here, and I trusted and I stepped out into the deep, and I took that new leadership position, and boy, that set me on a transformative life journey. Relocating led to an unexpected blessing. I went to Baltimore. Now, who is here from Baltimore? Okay, I won't talk about it. So I relocated to Baltimore. I got a wonderful raise, in fact, 20% more than what I was promised. But more importantly, I learned some lessons around letting go, surrendering, being obedient in my faith, all those things they supposedly teach us about. But I learned about myself. I learned about God. Now, I grew up in Sunday school. You know, the business of my family was church. So, hey, I knew a lot about God. In a nutshell, I learned what I wished I had been taught really in Sunday school, formation classes, summer camp, spiritual formation classes as an adult. Here's what I learned. God has the ultimate authority over my life. God has given us all that we need to live and to thrive in life. Yeah, thank you for that. All that we need, God has provided for us, and that God has made what I call superpowers, his superpowers available to us. Now, here's the big reveal. But there's a process to access those superpowers. In the text, Jesus reveals how to do this. There he goes talking in them parables. Sometimes can't you just speak plain? But anyway, he's talking about stuff, all right? And so I discern through this, not me, but the Holy Spirit that's in me, that there is a formula that helps us live in our superpower. Now, who out here has some superpower? Good. You're going to listen to what I got to say. The formula for using the superpower, I want to break it down for you. It's kind of like a recipe for accessing God's transformative, holy, anointed power in your life. Here's the formula. Y'all better write this down. I'm going to do a book on this later. One part surrender plus one part obedience multiplied by two times your faith. That equals power. You're going to have a test on this later. Let me say it again. The formula is one part surrender, one part obedience, plus 2x, two times your faith. That equals power. Remember what you're talking about. Well, let's find out what I'm talking about. In simpler terms, when we surrender completely, obey God's will, and have unwavering faith, we tap into an incredible source of strength and transformation. It is about letting go. It is about following God's lead and having deep trust. This is where our spiritual superpower lies. Now, I don't know about you, but I've seen some things in the world today that makes me think I need some superpower. Let me ask you,
If you knew this formula and you knew how to use this formula, would your life be better, worse, or the same?
Better.
Alrighty now. Definitely the same. It would be much better. The parable touches on the essence of surrender, obedience, authenticity, and faith. It reminds us that genuine faith is not merely a matter of words, but a transformed of heart, a surrendering of the often stuff that we say make us who we are. It is letting go of our, I gotta do this, can't only do that, Lord knows I need this, I should, I deserve. Now, if you guys watch TV, this is another free sermon I'm going to give you today, okay? If you watch TV, I would like for you to watch how many times you hear the word deserve. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. Yes, that pretty smile of yours, you deserve it. Where do we deserve stuff? Who tells us that we need to deserve stuff? That is imprinting in our psychology that I think does us a little bit of harm, because what we deserve is a better and closer relationship with God, but nobody tells us about that. Nobody says that if you do this, that you are accenting your superpower, and if you access your superpower, your son and your daughter, they will do as you command, as you ask, because you're living a life that is obedient to the life of God, where God then says, lay your hands on that child, ha, 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 and go on about your business, and trust that that child's life is safe. We don't kind of hear that anymore. But let me just share a story with you. And then I'm going to try to wrap up, because Lord, I can't keep y'all here all day. Although I have a ton of stuff to tell you, I won't. I have been captivated by the life of a very unique African-American woman, trailblazer, whose unwavering faith, her dedication to her calling, and complete trust in God inspires my ministry and speaks to the timeless God virtues that we will share today. Mother Mary Lang, that's her name. How many of you have heard of her? Oh, good, some of you have, wonderful. She hails out of Baltimore, right down the street, or maybe right up the street, someplace around here. To her, it was clear that faith knows no boundaries. It transcends backgrounds and experiences and culture. Mother Mary understood that faith was a universal force that unites us in our shared humanity, in our struggles, and in our sorrows. It is the bridge to our happiness, our hope, and our joys. It is the way we live our best lives. Now, Mother Mary, she did all kinds of things and had all kinds of obstacles before her, but she founded the first Black order of Black women nuns. Now, I wanted to be a nun before I married my husband. I looked everywhere for a nunnery, is what I call them, you know? I was like, oh, God, I just want to be so close to you, and I'm praying 5-10 times a day. Oh, God! I woke up one day, y'all, and I said, nope, change my mind, God. Nope, nope, nope. But in my pursuit, I ran across this order of women. It's too bad I didn't run across them before I was, you know, old. Or I probably would have joined them for her vision and her foresight. And then she just created stuff, schools and programming out of nothing. Out of nothing, because she knew her superpower. Her superpower was in her surrender of God, in her obedience to God's will, and to trusting that God had her back. Now, sometimes we forget that God has our back, but God has our back, and I'm grateful for that. And by the way, do you just know that she's one of the first Americans to be on her way to be canonized? What a wonderful treat and blessing that she get to be a saint. I'm like, I didn't even know such things. My ignorance was very obvious. But let me share a miracle, because now they need a miracle. They need for somebody to prove that this beautiful woman had some miracles. I was privileged to go to the retreat center. You know, her retreat center is not too far in Baltimore. It's kind of run down, guys, to be honest. It's not like Bon Secours. How many of y'all been to Bon Secours? Well, y'all know what I'm talking about, you know. They need some money. But nonetheless, I went there. I went to visit because I thought I still wanted to be a nun. And if I could be an associate nun of some type, that would be great. I was already married, and I just wanted to be an associate of that order. And going there, they took me to her prayer chamber. You know, they got all kinds of chambers and places you pray and, you know. And so I went to the prayer chamber to pray. And I want to talk about superpower, okay? And I don't want to talk because Reverend Teresa told me I only have 15 minutes. And so she said 20 at tops, all right? So I want to be judicious in what I say to you. So I went there. At the time, guys, I had two skin cancers, two rare skin cancers. One is anaplectic large cell lymphoma, rare in the population, even rarer as an African American. On my head were two golf balls, tumors the size of a golf ball, of golf balls. And you're probably saying, well, why were you even out? You should have stayed in the house. Nobody wanted to see that kind of thing. But I felt the urging of God to go. So I went. I was introduced to all of her sisters and her key people. Her people needed to be my people. And so I went. And as we were sitting there and praying, because everybody's praying for her sainthood, okay? We're all praying for her sainthood. And we went in the little chamber that was her little special prayer room thing, kind of, sort of. And so we put water on the tumor. That was two golf balls big. Immediately, I felt this kind of tingling sensation in my head, okay? And I'm like, ooh, something's going on here. Oh my God, maybe this tumor will disappear. It didn't disappear, but it started to go down. And I'm thinking, wow, what energy is this? What superpower is this? That at the touch of the water, the tumor goes down. I'm like, that's a mighty woman who had a connection to God, who somehow figured out a way to share that with others so she didn't keep everything to herself like we sometimes do. You know, I got this little bit of knowledge and I got this little bit of position and this is my superpower. But I am telling you, friends, brothers and sisters, beloved community, that we have not touched the power that God has placed within us. And that requires that we surrender a little bit more, okay? That we listen to God's word a little bit more. It's okay to question like the religious leaders do. Question all you want. Question and question. But know through your questions is a place of humility. It is a place where you finally recognize that you don't know it all and that there is something beyond your emotional intelligence, beyond your psychological willpower, beyond who you say you are in the world. And it is that space that I'm praying that more of us can walk in. Amen. Amen. Our churches must do this. Our churches are not providing what our people need, so they go hither and thither and thither. But if we can show them that the authority, the purpose, the intentionality, the love, the grace I had your president show me grace today. Peter showed me grace. You know, I'm a perfect person. Ask my husband. I'm a perfectionist. And if it's not perfect and not in the right order, and I'm also OCD, good God Almighty, I'm doing confessional. I'm OCD. So things aren't lining up, and sometimes he used to go through the house and just mess things up just to get, you know, he put the glass like crooked. He knows it needs to be in a straight line. But I'm saying this, my perfection is not enough. My perfection is not going to save me, and it's going to keep me from accessing all of my superpower. So I've been asking God to please let me give up my superpower. My superpower of being an OCD perfectioned woman. And until I do that, I am shortcutting what God can do for me in the world. Now, guys, I got this long old thought out. I did this sermon 8 times. How many? 8 times. 8 times I have rewritten this sermon. But I want to leave you with this, and I'm going to wrap up. We need our superpower. You're never too old to have a superpower. And we're never too young to teach our young kids about their superpower. We must teach them that they can ask all the kinds of questions they want. You must say to them, I may not have all the answers, but you are free to ask me that question. And in the asking of the question, it reveals that I don't know all the answers. And then I can turn that over to, oh, Lord, I love you. We say our higher power. I can turn it over to the divine. I can turn it over to the great spirit. I can turn it over to the Omega, the Alpha, the Omega. I can turn it over to something beyond me. And in the turning it over, God's got my back. God's walking with me and clearing the way and making it straight and making it plain for me. All right, so yes, I may not have met Mother Mary in person, but I certainly talked to her in my prayers. Yes, I may not be the brightest or the sharpest knife in the drawer. Is that how we say that? Yeah, but I'm pretty darn smart to understand that I'm not smart on my own, but it is by divine grace that I'm able to understand and comprehend. I want to leave you with a merciful God that loves us. A merciful God that's created for us a formula for us to access our superpower. You want to be a girl boss? Access your superpower. You want to move beyond the odds to kind of get in the way? Oh, trust me, I can write a list of things that have gotten in my way. But I know that my superpowers, my faith, my determination, my belief in the goodness of people, even though they don't show me that all the time, my belief that God has not turned her back on me. And so, I invite you today to experience your superpower. I invite you today to make a commitment this week. I'm going to do what that crazy Reverend Boyd said. I'm going to go into some time where I am quietly listening for that still speaking voice. And sometimes we can't hear it because we are all in ourselves. We're all into our thing, and you know, everybody tells you, do what you need to do for yourself. We need to do what we need to do for others. And in the doing of what we do for others, there's something magical that happens that allows us to have a breadth and a scope internally and externally that we do more for each other and ourselves. So let me wrap up.
I'm asking us to look at our inner light. Cynthia Bourdeau was one of the scholars that I used for my sermon today, and she points us to the inner world. She points us into the need to look at our egos and ourselves. She points us into the need to spend some quiet time. Okay, so if you can't meditate for 10 hours a day, okay. But can you walk in your garden for 5 minutes? Can you find a nature trail and stand there and let the trees speak to you? Do that in remembrance of God who has given you your superpowers, all right? And I promise you, your life will be different. I'm only here because I had some superpower that intuitively told me in the morning that I better go to the emergency room. Had I not gone to the emergency room, the doctor said that I would have died. See, that's how superpower works. Superpower nudges you, quietly directs you, so you don't get into crap and stuff. You know, you don't have to be exposed to the bully at school. We need to pray for our children. Mental illness is taking over the lives of our young children. If that's not enough to motivate you to find some superpower, I don't know what it is. Get your superpower. You can make a Batman coat or cloak if you want, or Wonder Girl's cloak, or whatever you need. Put your superpower on and let God work through you. And with that, I'm going to close this sermon, because in a minute I might start shouting and you will go, oh my God, what's going on up in that pulpit? And then I would have to explain to Reverend Sharissa and my good sister here that the Holy Spirit knocked me down. Then I start speaking in tongues. Oh, no. I'm United Church of Christ now, so I don't do that. All right, let us pray. And I know I have some names here to pray for in terms of healing. So I'm going to do this all in one way, if that's all right. I'm being rebellious, like one of the sons in our sermon today. I don't always like to do things like, you know, everybody wants me to do things. But if I can listen to the voice of God, if I can hear distinctively what God is asking of me, then you will get a better product from this servant leader. And so I'm listening to God's voice because I want to access my superpower. And my superpower keeps me out of trouble. It brings a husband to me. God, I wish I could tell that story. It brings a husband to me when statistics in society say that I should not have a black man working. That happens because I've done my work on myself so that the best of the best is available to me. That is my hope and my desire for you. I don't know what your need is, but I do know that you have some superpower. And my hope and my prayer and my wish for you is that this church, this lighthouse in this community, gets a whole bunch of superpower. Dear God, we thank you for the privilege of standing before your people. We thank you that I know I've probably forgotten something, omitted something, wanted to say something that I should say. But God, I trust that your people have been fed and nourished as only you can do. I pray that you would allow them to surrender to whatever it is they need to surrender, to hear your voice and to obey whatever it is you're asking them to do. Some of us are sitting on our gifts. Some of us are delaying our talents. And we're wondering where we're going to live in purpose. And I'm here to tell you, find your superpower, you find your purpose.
Dear God, we pray that you bless these that are on our morning prayer list, and we call out their names now as we continue to ask for healing for Barbara Rhodes, Trish Coffey, Autumn Crutchley, Tamara Timaeus, Leandra Coffey, Leanne Coffey. We're praying for the healing of Liam Cumbers' knee. We're praying for all of our college students. And you know, I'm going to put in there all of our students who are in middle school, who are in high school, and who are in kindergarten. And I'm going to pray, too, for our kids who are homeschooled. We give joyful thanks and praise for the newborn that is blessed to Cash Penn and Birkin Lynch. We thank God for new life. And we also are thankful for the son of Sandra Sando and Oliver Lynch, and for the grandson of Margie and Phil Birkenheimet. And if I have offended your name in some way, please forgive me. But I just want to say thank you, God, for this space of healing. Thank you, God, for these wonderful congregants, for the journey that they make and take. And God, reveal their superpowers. Don't let it be all day and all long. We need some superpowers up in the house. And so, Lord, we thank you for this. Thank you, God. Thank you for the miracles yet to be performed. In your holy and most gracious name we pray. Amen.
Next week is Consecration Sunday. Amen. Yes. We want to make sure that we are able to celebrate you, this church, and our commitments to be faithful stewards of God's resources. We have heard some wonderful reflections this season from Holly Davis, Matt Huding, and Justin Kuhn. And they've invited us to prayerfully consider the ways we've experienced generosity through this church and its people, and it prompted us to talk with God and with our families about what percentage God is calling of our income God is calling us to give in the coming year. I'm simply here this morning to make sure you know we're going to celebrate that next week, and that you are invited to join us at a table that will be filled with plenty of food options, including those that will meet, should meet, all dietary needs. So most importantly, I want to make sure that you know after service, after worship next week, we will have a time and a place where we can be the church together. We don't want to leave anyone out of that fun. So we're asking one final time for you to RSVP if you haven't had a chance to do that. We'll ask the ushers to come forward and just give them a little wave if you haven't had a chance to fill out a reservation card. If you're worshiping with us online, I invite you to contact the church office by phone or email so we know whether or not you can be with us. I'll give you a few minutes to complete those cards, and then the ushers will return to collect them. If you've already RSVP'd, you may want to use this time to pray or to meditate on the ways you've experienced generosity. Maybe continue to consider what God is calling you to give. Finally, as you pray this week on that question, what percentage of my income is God calling me to give, in anticipation of completing your estimate of giving next Sunday during the service as an act of worship, please consider the gifts you make as part of your regular giving, as well as those that you make towards mortgage assistance and debt reduction. I trust that God will use these gifts we commit next week to empower the ministry and mission of ERUCC for its discipleship, its work in justice, peace, and love.
Wasn't that a beautiful rendition? Thank you, choir. Thank you so very much for blessing us. And now we offer our prayer of dedication. And if you're able to stand, please do so. Gracious God, we do so with hearts filled with gratitude and surrender. Just as we surrender our doubts and questions, we surrender these offerings as symbols of faith and trust, divine goodness. Bless the gifts, gracious God. Use them to further your work, community, and beyond. May they be instruments of love, compassion, and transformation in the world. We surrender them to you,
knowing that your grace multiplies their impact. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hear these words as we enter our time of Holy Communion in prayer. One world spinning freely, yet too often fractured and confined. We too often find ourselves broken, alone, and feeling powerless. Remind us of the words written long ago to Timothy, encouraging him to rekindle his faith. Spark your fire within us, the fire that energizes and renews and brings new life to us and to the world. As a Samaritan paused to give Jesus thanks, so we gather on this day, people from around the world, to celebrate Christ's presence in our very midst. We use bread from our culture and from others as a potent symbol that you, our God, are the God of all people, that your love reaches not only us, but others besides. Open us to listen to them. Open us to learn from them. Open us to be present for them, not in patronizing and colonial ways, but in loving, equal, and Christ-like ways. This day we take communion with all the world and in doing so declare that Christ is present for all people, challenging unjust systems with God's challenge and promise. As we break bread and share a cup, may we remember the Christ present with us through all these years and across all this world, present with us as we rededicate ourselves to you. Amen.
We bless you, gracious one, for the presence of your Holy Spirit.
Today, Christ followers meet in public worship and secret gatherings to break bread together. Today, in grand churches and shantytown hovels, wine is shared in different languages by ordained clergy and faithful lay leaders. Jesus' Last Supper is remembered as these words are shared.
On the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus gathered for supper with 12 of his closest friends, his disciples. He took the unleavened bread of the Passover feast, and when he had given thanks to God for it, he broke it
and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, a new relationship with God, marked by the forgiveness of your sins. Drink it, all of you, the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are ready."
So before we come, I'm going to talk with us a little bit about people movement, because this is a different space today. I'll be sharing at this table, and Reverend Boyd will be at this table. The ushers, this table is kind of the more confusing flow. And so as you come forth in the aisle, if you'd let a space so that people in front of you can come, try a couple of different breads, and then meet me here to share in the cup. After you've drank from your cup, there's a bin right here that you can put your empty cup in. And so the movement here is going to go this way and double back on itself slightly. Here it's smoother. And so Reverend Boyd will stand at the end of this table with the cup. Thank you.